Raise your tartans. And let us pray. Almighty God, who has promised that in all places where you record your name, that you will meet with your servants to bless them, fulfill your sacred promise and make this field a place of power, heritage, courage, and prayer. May our worship be offered in the holy name of Jesus. May you bless us with the presence of your Holy Spirit. May you sanctify this time as profitable to your hearts and souls. We rejoice in this opportunity to dedicate these tartans to you as symbols of our unwavering loyalty, steadfast faith, and great achievements of our Scottish forefathers. We praise you for their ingenuity and their integrity, for their respect of truth and justice, for their rejection of hypocrisy, and for their regard of liberty, life, and equality of all people. Grant us, O God, the ability to remain true to the faith of our fathers, which has enlightened, encouraged, and enhanced the people of our beloved lands. Use us to bring peace and goodwill on earth and to advance equality and justice throughout the world. Through the name of our precious Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Post your tartans. We welcome you on this morning, this Reformation Sunday 2021. We thank you, both member and guest, for being here. We're here to remember our heritage, but we are also here to worship God. I would invite you to call ourselves to worship as you will look in the bulletin for the call. We have gathered together in search of Reformation. We stand fearless at the edge of change. God is in the midst of us, and we shall not be. Be still and know that God is God. God is our rock and our redeemer. Let us worship God.
You may be seated. If we say we have no sin, then we deceive ourselves. Let us now come together before the one who is able and ready to forgive our sins. Let us confess together. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your word. Amen. Sisters and brothers, this is the good news. God does not hold our sin against us, but pours out abundant grace. Give thanks to God, and by the Spirit's power, share the gospel far and near. In Jesus Christ, our sin is forgiven. Thanks be to God. I'd like to invite you all to stand as we together state what we believe. We confess and acknowledge one God alone, to whom alone we must cleave, whom alone we must serve, whom alone we must worship, and whom alone we put our trust, who is eternal, infinite, immeasurable, incomprehensible, omnipotent, invisible, one in substance, and yet distinct in three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, by whom we confess and believe all things in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, to have been created, to be retained in their being, and to be ruled and guided by God's inscrutable providence for such end as God's eternal wisdom, goodness, and justice have been, and to the manifestation of God's own glory. Please remain standing.
And let us pray. It is right and good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever proclaim the glory of your name. Amen. And please be seated. And let us continue in prayer. Lord, we gather this morning and offer these our prayers. We come together remembering thankful that you have invited us to gather in this place at this time. Lord, as we consider our heritage, we are especially grateful to our heritage that we find in Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We thank you, too, that as we gather together, we can know and be known by you. Lord, hear now our prayers. We offer prayers for our nation, Lord. For we do not understand all that is going on. We find ourselves concerned, worried, even fearful as to what might come to pass. But Lord, we are so thankful that we know that the future is yours. You hold us and all that is before us in the palm of your hand. Knowing that evil and knowing that unrighteousness and knowing that hate and greed will not destroy the goodness that you have ordained for your people. So allow our hearts and our minds to be focused on you and your goodness. Let us not be held back by fear, but instill within us the courage to be your people at a time like this. We pray for our president, we pray for the Congress, we pray for the courts, that they would, Lord, be agents of your justice. agents of your righteousness, that they would bring your truth. Lord, we pray that you would lift up those who will be witnesses for you now and forever. We pray for those who bring your gospel. Take that gospel to the uttermost parts of the world, Lord. We pray for their protection and their keeping. And we pray for the world in which they take the gospel. A world that is riveted by hate, misunderstanding, desire for power. Lord, pour out your spirit of peace and healing upon your world. Lord, we pray for your spirit to guide all that is done here this morning, that our hearts will be open to receive you, that we will sense your presence at work even here in this place. Lord, give each of us a sense of your goodness, that we might even be removed from the cares of the day and be lifted by the understanding that you are the one that loves and forgives. Lord, we pray for your church and pray that it will continue to bring your gospel with clarity, with power, but bring it in humility. With a sense of service, with hearts of gratitude. So now guide us this day, O great Jehovah. Supply all our needs and reveal yourself to those areas of our life where we need you and only you. And we ask all of this in the precious name of Jesus and pray that prayer that he has invited us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Our first scripture reading this morning can be found in your Old Testament Bibles, in your Pew Bibles, Old Testament, page 3, Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 13. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. They heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees in the garden. But the Lord called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
As the choir was singing the prayer response, I was reminded of when I was called into the ministry, there was so much that I would need that I prayed and I prayed and I prayed for what all I thought I would need it to have. And I realized that I did not pray that God would supply me with a booming voice so I would not need to have it amplified. So maybe that's what we start doing tomorrow. In any event, I have always been challenged by amplification. Our second reading comes from Matthew, familiar verses from the Sermon on the Mount. Here now again, these words that Jesus spoke to his disciple and those others who had gathered to hear him speak about what was all this about this kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? What does it look like? What do we do? Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law of the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Truly, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I don't want to scare any of the young people here today, but I will tell them that the experts say that we grow up to be just like our parents. And as I get older, I realize that there's some truth to that. So again, if that's a big shock to some of y'all, just persevere. You know, I look around and I say to myself, everything's going to pot. And I remember that that's what my father used to say. Years and years ago, I can remember him just kind of shaking his head after reading the newspaper in the evening and just saying, "We are going to pot." That's an interesting phrase. I did not really know where it came from, but as you know, we have that special place we go, that Google place, and it tells us that this expression, "gone to pot," became popular use in the 15th century. And it was to describe what was going on with meat after it really wasn't fresh enough to eat, so you would put it in the stew pot. And I look around and I still say, I think things are going to pot. There was more stuff spoiling in the 15th century. What was going on in the church? This morning is Reformation Sunday. We remember what happened back then. We again reminded of what was happening in the church, and the gospel was being spoiled by the institution of the church. The church, you see, was deciding that it would dispense the mercy, it would dispense the grace, it would be the one which would forgive. and would usually do it to the highest bidder. You see, it was spoiled. There was a conflict going on then. It was a conflict from that institutional Catholic Church and those early reformers who saw that the gospel was God alone, was Christ alone, was mercy and grace alone. And they believed it so deeply. They were willing to lay their lives down to see that it was a good stew that began to boil. There were other conflicts going on too. This is Kirking of the Tartans, and it reminds us of that conflict between the English and the Scots, which gave rise to the Tartans and those dark times when your family heritage had to be hidden because it was law and you could lose your life. Conflict continues everywhere. And I believe it has, we know, for the last thousands of years. Whether it's politics or whether it's national, international, whether it's with families or relationships, there are just these divisions, these clashing of interests, these clashing of self-interests that give rise to what we call conflict. And it all stems from ideas and ideals that just are not compatible. But we know that that's nothing new. We pick up our Bible and we go back to the third chapter of Genesis. And we keep reading, and if we get our way all the way to the 21st chapter of Revelation, all that's there is conflict. More a conflict of kingdoms. The conflict of that kingdom which was good and which was created by God, and the kingdom of this world that was an absence of good, and these ideals and these ideas clashed over and over and over again. Oh, I'm not talking about the clashing of swords and chariots and soldiers, although that's in here. No, this more subtle thing, this evil force, we call him the devil, or we call him Satan, or we call him all sorts of things, but he's personified just a kingdom that is opposed to the goodness and the greatness of God's own creation. You see, the kingdom of God is and has always been beating up against the kingdom of this world. Oh, they're not battles as we think of them in terms of guns and swords and bows and arrows, but as the scripture tells us, the one that leads that kingdom is much, much, much more subtle. Subtle more than all other creation. You see, he was not there to beat you on the head, but he's there to tempt you, to encourage you in the way he thinks, to excite you as what he might have to offer. That's the conflict that we see, that subtle conflict that we sometimes miss. And at its core is good versus evil, right versus wrong, truth versus lies, life opposed to death, light and darkness. Very subtle. And we cannot avoid it. And it has been going on and will continue to go on as those kingdoms are in conflict and we continue to be enticed, as we continue to be tempted. We look in the Old Testament and we see that God's people, they were kind of responsible for looking after the kingdom of heaven, the godly kingdom that was before them. But we see that neither the law nor the prophets, oh, they couldn't help them, could they? For time and time again, the temptations worked, the excitement got their attention, and they found themselves moving away from the goodness that God had created to that which would bring death and destruction and darkness. But there was hope. There was hope for someone who would come, someone who could save them from all this, the Messiah. And he came. But we see that the people wanted a king who would come and destroy maybe Rome, maybe the existing way of life. But this king came not to destroy, unless it was to destroy evil, to overcome death. No, this Messiah came to also be an influence, but an influence for the world, to goodness, to life, to truth. And this Messiah called his people to be with him on this journey. And I think it is so interesting in the Sermon on the Mount that as Jesus was trying to explain to these people in the first century of what they were to be doing within this kingdom that he was building, he said, strange thing, you are to be salt. But if we'll stop and look at what that word meant to the first century Hebrew, you'll know that it was much more important a word than we use today. I mean, I think about it when I want salt, it's to make my food taste a little better. It's just a condiment that might sit on the table or in the kitchen. But to this first century Hebrew, it was much, much more than a condiment. It was a commodity. You see, it was currency. Salt was very, very important. That word comes from the Latin word salarius. It means salary. You see, salt was as important as one's salary. It was important in the life. They understood it, especially the Hebrew. The Hebrew understood that salt made all the difference for them. Oh yeah, we know that it makes food taste better. But for that early Hebrew, for that person that was listening to Jesus, they all also understood that salt made things pure. Things they could not otherwise eat, things that otherwise wouldn't go into the stew pot would be going into the garbage, that the salt could make it pure. Kosher salt, we call it today. But even more than that is this understanding that salt will preserve. Keep that food fresh, even in spite of what might be going on. Do you kind of see what Jesus is saying to them about how they are to be in this world? To make things better. To, in fact, make things more pure and lasting. Do you hear the message to the church today about being salt in a world that's gone to pot? The need for that purity, that need to influence for good, to bring the purity of the gospel, that it's Jesus Christ and Christ alone that can offer forgiveness to you and to me. Jesus went on to say more, that you are to be the light. And I believe that first century Hebrew understood much more about light and its impact on life than we do today. We have all the light we want, don't we? If we pay our bill. But we have the electricity we need. We have the light bulbs. We don't even think about it. We just flip the switch in the morning when we get up. That was not true in the first century. I mean, when the sun went down and it became dark, things could be dangerous. But a little light, just a little light, can really make a big difference in a lot of darkness. You see, the light will overcome the darkness. Never will the darkness overcome the light. Do you see the message that Jesus was trying to get these people to understand then? Do you see the message he's trying to get us to understand today about being the light of the world? No one starts a light burning and then puts it under a basket. No, Jesus was saying that it is the light of righteousness that we are to guide a dark world toward. It's our responsibility to make that difference, to be involved in the conflict. You see, it's the fullness of the gospel that is declared but also lived out in the lives of those who claim to follow Jesus. I've heard it said, God does not care how high you jump for Jesus, but God does care how straight you walk when you land. You see, that's what it's all about today. It's what was all about in the first century. It's walking the walk. Being the light for the world. And it's more and more important the darker the world gets. Conflict will always be with us at most every level, and for the most part at its core there is that difference of good and evil, right and wrong. And I believe Jesus was calling those disciples then, and he is calling us today. He's not calling us to pick up a gun. He may be calling us to lay down our life. You see, that's the way the kingdom of God is at work. The kingdom of God does not need anyone who might destroy their enemy. The kingdom of God needs someone who will love their enemy. The kingdom of heaven does not need someone who will go out and harm others, even though they may be harmful themselves. The kingdom of heaven needs people who will love their neighbor as themselves. Yes, there's conflict, but we are called not to be part of the conflict, but to be the ones who influence those who are caught in the darkness to find the light. And we're called today to be salt and to be light. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
Typically, at Eastminster, we would finish up here and go down for a nice cookie social. That's not going to happen today. However, as you leave, you will notice a little basket in the center of the narthex, and there's a little bag of shortbread cookies that are just packed just for you. So take those and remember the days when we used to get together, and look forward to the day we will again get together.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Oh, the varsity. This is announcement time. If you get tired, you can sit in. Next week, we are going to gather outside the varsity. It's not a tradition here, but it would be nice to be. It's a tradition in my family. That's where you like to go eat. It will be a time of celebration as we welcome our new members. So I would encourage you to make reservations by the 2nd and be here next Sunday, and we'll enjoy fine dining on the patio, as they say. It is amazing grace that God would look down on you and me with an attitude of love and say, I want to draw you unto myself. I want to give you all that is good. I want you to have a life that is exceptional. That's amazing grace that he had to come and he had to die and he had to conquer death to secure that. And we need to remember that. And remember that we are called to be salt and light. We are called to be a difference. You see, the reason we've gone to pot is people don't know where they're going. They're looking in all the wrong places, doing all the wrong things. And it is up to you and to me to be salt and light so that everyone can fully receive the grace of God through Jesus Christ. So we go from this place in the love of God, in the power of His Spirit, and the mercy and grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, now and forever. Amen.